Hello all. I want to welcome you to today's class once again. Today we will be starting our lectures in chapter 2, and I will have two lectures recorded for this chapter. The first part of it is what we're going to be doing today. So today we'll be looking at atoms and molecules. This basically tries to tell us the particulate nature of matter, what we can see in matter, what are those small particles we can see in matter. Then we'll try to understand the structure of matter as we move on. As usual, you would have known this by now. As you saw in my notes, I start every of my class with a quote. Now, today's quote is an anonymous quote. I can't remember where I picked it from. I labored to get there. To get the source, but I didn't get it. So I was anonymous. So he said, "You can do anything, just get up and do it. Follow your dreams." Now, I want to challenge you that as you take this class, as you navigate through the challenges of being a student, that you can do anything. You can pass any course. You can achieve anything. Nobody can stop you. The only person that can stop you from not achieving your dream is yourself. I used to remember this quote that says that no army of this world can stop a dream whose time has come. So if you this is your time, this is the time to follow your dreams and achieve it. Just do it. Do not be afraid of failures, even as you move on in this class. Let's get started. The first thing I have here is my learning objectives or my learning goals. I'm not going to be reading this. This is a video lecture. I would always advise you to take time to read this through learning goals, internalize them yourself, and then begin to fill out your learning goal flashcards. Okay, so that is what you're going to do for yourself as we move on. Now we start. The first thing we need to talk about are the symbols and formulas of element. You see, the periodic table, I still say it every day, that the periodic table represents the holiest of the books in this world. The periodic table is a repertoire or is an encyclopedia of all the elements that make up all matter on earth. There is no information you cannot get there. So every element is represented by a unique symbol. It has a unique name and a unique symbol. Now, and most of these symbols either represent the name of individuals, great scientists, or the name of places. It could also represent the name of the founders of the element. So, based on the elemental properties, it is this unique name and symbol is used to represent each element. And these names are based on either the elemental properties, or they are derived from the names of famous scientists, like I said earlier, places and astronomical bodies, or even some mythological characters. Now, each of these elements are represented by symbols, and these symbols are based on that name of the element. And there are two things that usually happen. One, some elements are made up of only one single letters. If they're made up of a single letter, that means they have to be represented by a capital letter, a capital or uppercase letter. Now, some of them have two names. Are represented or symbolized by two alphabets. That means it has to be the first letter will be an alphabet like this case, and the second letter will have to be a small letter. Now, if you look at these, the other ones, let me use a different color for them. You find out that fluorine and sulfur are single letters. And because they are single letters, each of those letters has to be written in an upper case. And that is a rule and a must that it has to happen. Now, on the other hand, remember in chapter one, the first lecture, we defined that compounds consist of the pure substances that are made up of two or more elements that are chemically combined together, or atoms that are chemically combined together, or that can only be physically chemically separated rather. So each compound is presented, each compound is actually represented by symbols of elements. Now, each element represents one atom of that element. And If you have more than one atom in that element, we now use a subscript to represent that. We use a subscript. You cannot use a superscript for that. You must have to use a subscript for that. Now, a subscript, of course, you know, if I have, let me try to show, of course, just to remember, a subscript simply means if I have x value and I want to write a subscript, let me use a different color as a green. So what it means is that my A here represents a subscript. So this is what I mean by a subscript. So it has to be written in this format for it to be correct. So let's look at some of the things we have in there. Now we have carbon monoxide here. Carbon monoxide is made up of one atom of carbon and one atom of oxygen. And that is the name carbon monoxide. Now, when the subscript is one, you do not have to represent, you do not have to write it. But when it is more than one, you just need to show us that. A good example of that is this one. Look at the number two, NO2. The subscript is two and it is fully represented. So this is nitrogen dioxide. Look at water. Water is actually H2O, or you can say dihydrogen monoxide. Here, hydrogen has two atoms and it is fully represented in the case of this. In the case of sodium chloride, an ionic compound, each of these guys just have only one atoms, and they are not, of course, if you have one as a subscript, you do not show that. Now look at another one here, the nitric acid. Nitric acid consists of one atom of hydrogen, one atom of nitrogen, and two atoms of oxygen, and two oxygen atoms are properly represented by the subscript of two. You see that is very clear on its own. So this is the way we represent compound. So problem one, it says the symbol calcium carbonate, the symbol calcium carbonate represents which of the following? The first thing we need to look at it. One, this is a pure substance. That's the first thing we need to figure. Number two, this pure substance is made up of 1, 2, 3 atoms that are chemically combined together. And that fits the exact definition of what we know as a compound, and that becomes the answer. We go to the next page. Problem two, it says, write the formulas for the following compound. We should write the formulas for the following compound. The first one says nitrogen dioxide, one nitrogen atom and two oxygen atoms. Now, remember, we said that if you have more than one atom of an element, it has to be represented with what? With a subscript of that number. So let's start. It has one atom of nitrogen. We're going to have N. Nitrogen is represented by N. Since it's only one, now you have to, what are you going to be doing? You have to keep your periodic table as you're listening to this class by your side and use it to understand at every level of my explanation. If you go to the periodic table, nitrogen is number 7. You see it has a symbol of N, capital. And then it has two atoms of oxygen. So oxygen has one atom, O, but because we have two atoms, it's going to be NO2. We go again. It says sodium phosphate. Sodium phosphate, 3 atoms of sodium is given. So we have sodium. Sodium has 3 atoms. You put it as a subscript. One atom of phosphorus, P. Only one atom, we don't have to say that. And oxygen has 4 atoms. This becomes the formula of sodium phosphate. You can always pause this video, practice this, and come back and see how they are done. Another good example, it says a white solid glucose is made up of 6 atoms of carbon, 12 atoms of hydrogen, 6 atoms of oxygen. Write the chemical formula of glucose. Let's start. Now we start 6 atoms of carbon. Carbon is C, write C. 6 atoms is 6. Another one, 12 atoms of hydrogen. Hydrogen is H. It has 12 atoms, so it's going to be 12. And 6 atoms of oxygen. Oxygen again is O. And there are how many atoms? So the formula for this compound is 6 is H12O6. And that is the white solid called glucose. Now, let's go to the structure of the atom. This is just the second objective. You know, we've been talking about atoms a lot, and what does an atom look like? You see, atom has undergone a lot of evolution in understanding. It has undergone a lot of changes, a lot of changes the way we understand what it is. So we are going to be talking about that at this point. So the modern structure of atom is that an atom is made up of 3 subatomic particles. Those three subatomic particles are called the protons, the neutrons, and the electrons. These are the three things that are made up of an atom. I know at a point in time, there was this understanding that atom cannot be broken down further into any particle. But with the increase in better equipment and with sophistication of science, we've been able to crack in through that and understand the atom actually contains three smaller particles that are just listed. Now, the next thing we're going to talk about is where are these guys located? Now, the first thing we need to see, an atom is made up of a centrally placed nucleus. Now, if you look at these things, I think I'm going to use my highlight for it. Now, this is the centrally placed nucleus of an atom. If you look at that, if you look at these two colors, now you see the protons, the neutron is the red, and the proton, okay, let me undo that. Maybe that will be clear. Now, if you look at this now, I have the protons and the neutrons. See, the protons is the green here, and the neutron is the red. Now, both of these guys are placed at the center of the atom, and that center of the atom is what we called the nucleus. So we say they are tightly bound together to form the central portion of the atom called the nucleus of the atom at the center. Now, around the center of the atom, we have fast moving electrons that circle themselves around this nucleus outside the nucleus. Now, these electrons are in constant motion. And of course, most times I tell my students electrons don't sleep because they keep moving and they keep moving and they move almost all the time. Now, so they're located outside the nucleus of the atom. That's where they're located. And they move rapidly throughout the relative large space or the large volume surrounding the nucleus like a cloud. They move like a cloud. So there is no particular or defined orbit where these guys actually circle, but just they keep moving around the orbit and around the orbit and form a kind of cloud, as you can see from this structure. So look at the electrons. Now, the old understanding of atoms is that they moved around in concentric circle. We call that the Bohr's model. In the next chapter, on the next few chapters, we're going to understand and see that this particular convention has been changed, and we are now moving forward with this particular understanding that electrons are actually moving around as a cloud around the nucleus, not in a specified concentric circle. So these are the structures of the atom. So if we go further, we see what are the characteristics of these subatomic particles. These subatomic particles, like we said, are the electrons, the proton, and the neutron. Now, the electron, which of course we said earlier, the electron is located outside the nucleus and they move around in that relatively large space. Now, the electron represented by E has a negative charge, has a charge of -1. Its weight is very small and almost negligible, and we do not consider the weight or the mass of an electron when deciding the overall mass of the atom. So this is the mass in gram, 9.11 times 10 raised to the power negative 28. And then in AMU, it represents 1/1836, and it is located outside the nucleus. Now, what about the proton? The proton, of course, is equal in charge to the electron. As you can see, it is equal in charge to the electron. The electron is 1 minus, this is 1 plus. It is represented by the symbol P. And of course, if you look at this, it has a relatively larger mass when you compare to this. So the mass of this guy is 1/1836 times. So the electron is 1/1836 times the mass of this guy. That is to tell you that it is actually very, very small. So the weight of this in AMU is 1, and it is located inside the nucleus. The same thing with the neutron. The neutron, on the other hand, is N. It has no charge. It is neutral. That is where the name came from. It's a neutron. If you look at the name neutron, we can just say it came from neutral. So that is where that name came from. It has no charge. And it has exactly the same mass as the, if you look at these two masses are the same mass with the proton. And in fact, the sum of the proton plus the neutron is what actually makes up the mass of the atom. We're going to see very soon. Both of these guys make up the mass of the atom. And then the mass again in AMU is 1. And is also located inside the nucleus of the atom. Now, it says, which of the following particles is found inside the nucleus of an atom and has a positive charge? Of course, by that definition, this must be a proton, because this is negatively charged. It doesn't fit in. Neutron has no charge. And then we did not talk about the positron. The positron, something else happened. So this fits into this definition, and that will be the choice of your answer. Now, atomic and mass numbers. Atomic number and mass number. What does that mean? Now, the atomic number, or the proton number, is represents the number of protons in any atom. I usually tell students that the proton number is just the serial number of an atom. In fact, you can say that this represents the social security number, SSN, of an atom. No two atoms can have the same number, just like no two individuals in the United States will have the same social security number. And it is always equal to the number of protons in an atom. And it is represented by the symbol Z. Now, the mass number, or what we call the atomic mass, represents the sum of the number of protons and the number of neutrons in the nucleus of an atom. Remember earlier when we looked at the characteristics of an atom, I said that the electron itself, because it's so small, the electron does not contribute to the mass of an atom. The electron does not contribute to the mass of an atom. It is so small that we assume that the mass is very much negligible. So the mass of the atom is only contributed by the proton and the neutron. And that formula I usually make for students to know is to use the formula that A is equal to P plus N, where P is the number of protons and N is the number of electrons. We're going to see. Now, I want you once again to look at your periodic table. If you're listening to this class, get your periodic table and look at it. Keep it by your side. You see, the periodic table, if you look at the periodic table, this problem says, based on the information given below, what is the atomic number Z and atomic mass A of magnesium? Now, if you take up your periodic number, you see, the format I've written this is that the periodic number is written this way. The periodic number has the formula of the element written. On top of it, you find a number, and down it, you find another number. Now, this number is what we call the atomic number. The atomic number, of course, I told you the atomic number is represented by the symbol Z, and this number is what we call the mass number. You call it the mass number or atomic mass, whichever one you call it is okay. A. Now, it says, based on information, what is the atomic number? So, the atomic number of this element, the atomic number Z of magnesium, is 12. That is why magnesium is number 12 if you're looking at the periodic table. Whereas the atomic number of magnesium from that number is simply represent 24.31, the number that is written below the number in your periodic table. All right. And it's good you begin to understand how to use the periodic table in solving some problems. So you're going to be seeing a lot of that as we move on. Now it says, what is the mass number and the atomic number for an atom that contains 7 electrons, 7 protons, and 8 neutrons? What is the mass number? Now, the first thing you need to do is to look at your periodic table. Now, but the information is clear. It says, first of all, it says, what is the mass number? Remember what I told you earlier, that the mass number A of an atom just simply represents the number of protons plus the number of electrons. Now we look at it. We see the electrons. The electrons do not contribute to the mass of an atom. But here we have what? The protons and the neutrons. So what do you do? The proton is 7 plus the neutron is 8. If you add these two together, it's going to give you 15. So what that simply means is that the mass number A of this atom is equal to 15. And that says, what is the atomic number? Again, what is the atomic number? The atomic number, since it has 7 protons, what that tells us is that the atomic number is equal to what? 7. Because that is the same number. The atomic number represents the number of protons. So you will be conversant with these things as we move on. And we're going to use it to solve more problems as well. So it says, what is the atomic number and the mass number for an atom that contains 20 electrons, 20 protons, and 21 neutrons. So look at the question. What is the atomic number and the mass number? Again, it contains 20 protons, which first deal with that one. What that simply means is the atomic number Z is equal to 20. So you can start to say, what element is that? Of course, we know that the element is going to be calcium. Calcium has an atomic number of 20. Now, that's only the first question. The second question says, what is the mass number? Again, mass number A represents equal to Z, which is number atomic number plus N. Oh, that's my bad. I think this is wrong. Let me use proton. It represents number of proton P plus number of neutron. Again, the number of proton we have here is what? 20 plus the number of neutron we have here is 21. And when you add that two, it's going to give you 41. So this element is actually calcium. It has an atomic number of 20, an atomic mass of 41. If we take that further to the next slide, isotopes. Then let's define isotopes. Isotopes are atoms that have the same number of protons in the nucleus, but have different numbers of neutrons. In fact, isotope in itself simply means the existence of an atom that has the same number of protons. Now, this is the same atom. Because it's the same atom, how do we know? It has the same number of protons. Of course, the protons is the SSI number, is the same. But what's the difference? They usually have a twin or a triplet. And the reason why they do that is because the number of neutrons in their nucleus is different. So what that simply means is that they have the same atomic number, but different what? Mass number. So all isotopes of the same element will always have the same number of electrons outside the nucleus and the same number of protons. So if you look at this picture, let's look at this picture down here. You see chlorine here, there's chlorine 35 and there's chlorine 37. Now chlorine 35 has, of course, look at this number, is written up here. This means that both of them have the 17 as the number of their protons. Now what that simply means is that the number of protons must be equal to the number of electrons. For a neutral atom, that must be equal. However, what brings the existence of isotopy is the number of neutrons in the atom. If you look at this, the number of neutrons in this atom is 18 and the number here is 20. And how do we get that number? Remember earlier the formula I gave you, that A, let's remember that A now is equal to what? P plus N. If I solve for N, N simply means A minus P. If you use this formula, let's see. What that simply means is that 35 minus 17 is going to give you 18. Whereas for this one, 37 minus 17 is going to give you 20. So you can use this formula, rearrange it, and use it to actually solve for the number of neutrons in an atom. What you simply need to do is to do a simple mathematical rearrangement. So this is what we call. So in this kind of thing, it's very interesting, but you find that an atom will have a twin brother. The difference is that the little one is either a little bit heavier or a little bit lighter than the other. We go to the next slide, isotopic representation. You see, isotopes are represented with an interesting symbol. Now, students tend to confuse this representation with what we saw earlier. Remember what I showed you earlier? In the periodic table, you have a box, you have an element, you have the atomic number Z up, and you have the atomic mass A down. No, this is wrong. This is correct, I mean to say, for the periodic table. But this is different when we come to the isotope. An isotopic representation usually puts a superscript and a subscript to the left of the symbol of the atom. If you look at this now, this is to the left side of the symbol of this atom, E. Now, the A here, of course, represents the atomic mass, and the Z, the superscript A is the atomic mass, and the subscript Z represents atomic number. Let me say it again. The superscript A represents the atomic mass. The subscript Z represents the atomic number or the number of protons. And that is what I just said in my notes. So Z is the atomic number. A is the atomic mass or the mass number. You can call it the mass number or atomic mass. It doesn't really matter. I tried to use that a few times too. Or atomic mass. So it doesn't really matter whichever one you feel you want to use. So it doesn't really change anything. So, well, I'm trying to see that I wrote that even better. So, or atomic mass. So let it be very clear. Now, E, of course, represents the elemental symbol of the atom. So let's look at this. So now this is a good example of sulfur. Sulfur here has a superscript of 33. This 33 represents the atomic mass of A, and it has a subscript that is represents Z, which is the atomic number. So this symbol represents an atomic isotope of sulfur that contains 16 protons and 17 neutrons in the nucleus. How do we get the 17 neutrons? Again, the number of neutrons will be, if you do 33 minus 16 is going to give you 17. You can use your calculator to find out that. Now, and then we can also now use that to identify the full name of an atom. So you can call an atom by its mass. So what do you say? So every atom, if you want to write the full name of an atom, simply what you do is that is represented by the elemental name and followed by the mass number. What does that mean? So if I want to call the name of this atom now, I'm going to say sulfur 33. Sulfur 33. Remember, sulfur is the name followed by the last name is their atomic mass. So I usually tell students that the last name of an atom is its atomic mass. So you can have chlorine. Like if you go back to what we had earlier here, if you go back to the previous page, we can say this is chlorine 35 and this is chlorine 37. That is how we say the full names of atom. All right. So going to the next slide, it says, what are the mass number, atomic number, and the isotope symbol for an atom that contains 23 protons and 28 neutrons? Now we start from the first one. These are three questions. So we treat this as A, B, and C. So if we're going to do A, say, what is the atomic number or the mass? Sorry, what is the mass number? So the mass number of an atom A, of course, again, A simply means the number of protons plus the number of what? Neutrons. And what that will be, if you look at this, it contains 23 protons and 23 protons and 28 neutrons. So what are we going to do? It's going to be 23 plus 28, and that will be equal to 51. So the atomic mass of this atom is 51. Again, it says, what is the atomic number? Let's call that B. The atomic number represents the number of protons. Again, remember that. If he has 23 protons, what that simply tells us is that Z, which is the atomic number, is equal to what? 23. Now, how do we now know the symbol of this element? You now pick up your periodic table. I'm looking at my periodic table here. If you look at the periodic table, an atom that has an atomic number of 23 or the serial number 23 or the SSN 23 is vanadium. And vanadium has a symbol of V. What do I do? And I go to the left side and put my atomic mass. The atomic mass usually has a subscript 51, and the atomic number will be the atomic mass will be a superscript, which what I did just did, this is called a superscript. Then the subscript is going to be the atomic number, which is 23 written as. So this is the symbol of vanadium. In fact, if I want to say the name of this atom, this is going to be vanadium 51. That is how I'm going to say the name of this atom, vanadium 51. That's how say the name of this atom. Let's go to the next one. It says, how many neutrons are contained in an atom of zinc 67? Write the isotopic symbol of the element. Now, the first question, it says, how many neutrons? Remember again, the first thing you need to do, zinc is number 30 in the periodic table. So it's not bad. You look, use your periodic table. Since it has a number 30 in the periodic table, what it means that Z of it is equal to that. That's what it means. The Z or the atomic number of zinc is 30. What I simply also mean is that since Z is equal to the atomic number is equal to the number of proton, what simply means that the number of proton is also equal to what? 30. We settle with that one. It now says, how many neutrons? Of course, from what we're giving here now, from the name of this zinc, we know that zinc 65 simply means is that the atomic mass of zinc is what? 67. That is exactly what it means. Remember what I told you earlier, that this, the last name is represented by the atomic mass. And if we know that is the distance, so what do we do? He says, how many neutrons? We'll rearrange this equation again. Remember, I'm going to write if A is equal to Z or P, let me use P. You can use P or Z. P plus N. What that simply means is that n will be equal to a minus b. So if we put that, if I put everything together, I'm going to have 67, which is my atomic mass established, minus my atomic number 30, and that is going to give me 37. So what it means is that the number of neutron contained in this atom is 67. And if I want to write that atomic symbol, of course, zinc is represented by the symbol Zn. It has an atomic mass of 67 as a superscript, an atomic number of 30. And that represents the isotopic symbol of zinc. Now, you can always pause this video, try to practice these problems yourself, and come back to them once again. So let's go to problem 9 again. It says, how many protons, electrons, and neutrons are contained in an atom with a mass number of 26 and a symbol of Mg? Of course, that atom is magnesium. Of course, it's not magnesium. Mg simply means magnesium. And now, what do we do first? We want to know the serial number. Magnesium is number 12. What that simply means is that Z of magnesium, the Z of magnesium simply is equal to 12. And of course, since it's 12, remember that P is equal to Z. And what that simply means is that P, the number of proton here, is equal to 12. We get that established. It says how many protons. So it contains 12 protons. Now, and that is it. So, it says how many protons, electrons. Now, of course, I told you earlier. So let's see this at the first question. The second question says how many electrons. Of course, I told you the number of protons in a neutral atom is equal to the number of what? Electrons. What that simply means is that, of course, this is for a neutral atom. We're going to talk about when it is non-neutral. We're dealing with all neutrons here. What that simply means is that it also is equal to what? 12 electrons. That's what we have inside this atom. And it says, what is the number of neutrons? Again, of course, it has a mass number of 26. Remember again, when I ran this equation, I said that number of protons is actually atomic number minus the number of neutrons is equal to atomic number minus number of protons. And if you put this thing together, A here is 26. We got it. This is A for us. This is A for us. And then minus the P here is 12, and that is equal to 14. So what it means, the number of neutrons in this atom is 14. Right. And if you have any questions about these things, once again, I will advise you to always pull back, do your work, do your problems. This is a very good example of practice. So I will advise you for this question, for this problem, is for you to step back a little bit, pause this video, read this thing once again, and come back and do it. This is a very good question where you can take a breather and come back a little bit. So that's what you're going to do. You can take a breather in this kind of problem and come back a little bit. So at this point in time, we're going to solve this problem. So we're going to pause it and then let's solve the problem. Now, so if you look at that, so let's deal with those problems. Like with the knowledge we have of all those problems now, we can easily solve this problem. So from here, you say chlorine, what is the number of electrons it contains? Of course, chlorine is number 17. The proton number is number 17 because the atomic number is 17. So we can easily write that first. We can just put that first. This is 17. So what it means is that since this is a neutral atom, 17, number of protons equals number of electrons. So we're going to put 17 here again. And what next we're going to do? The mass number. You say, what is the mass number? For us to get the mass number, remember, the mass number simply means the number of protons plus the number of what? Remember that? The number of protons plus the number of what? You add this column plus this column. So when you add these two together, it's going to give you what? It's going to give you 36. And then what is the name of this guy? The name of this guy, remember I said it is, you're going to say the full name, chlorine. You're going to put a hyphen, 36. That is how we name this atom. The next one, we move. It says here, it says the proton number is 20. That means the atomic number is 20. An element that has an atomic number of 20, of course, is calcium. That would be the symbol. So what that simply means is that we want to figure out the mass number. What is the mass number? The mass number will be to add this column of protons and neutrons together. And when you do that, you're going to get what? 42. And then, Since we know this is calcium, how do we name this? We say this will be calcium hyphen 42. Now, the last but not the least is, say, oxygen. Oxygen is number what? Of course, oxygen is represented by the symbol O. And we know that oxygen is number 8 in the periodic table. So what that simply means is it has 8 protons. And the protons will always equal to the number of what? Electrons. And of course, we want to find out how many neutrons it contains. How do we do that? Remember the formula? Always remember that formula. That the number of neutrons is atomic mass minus the number of protons. And atomic mass is given here. This is the atomic mass. So we put that first. This is 16. And for us to get the number of neutrons, we're going to do 16 minus 8. And that also gives us 8. So and that is how we solve this problem. So you can always pause this video, finish it, come back and check for comprehension and understanding. And let us move to the next problem. It says, practicing how to write isotopic symbol of element. It says, for the following, carbon 13. If you want to write carbon 13, how do you write the symbol? Carbon is number 6 in the periodic table. So carbon 13 will be C. Of course, the atomic number will be, and the atomic mass is going to be this. So this is carbon this. And carbon 14 simply means C. The atomic number doesn't change, but atomic mass is 14. So these are two isotopes of another. Another good example. So the first thing, just use a periodic table to figure out the number of protons it contains, which is the serial number, and use that to write this. Again, for uranium, uranium has an atomic number of 92. So you look at the periodic table, and it has a symbol of U. And U, let me write the two of them, and U. Now, uranium 35 weighs 235. Since it is number 32, that will be my subscript. Again, this weighs uranium 238, that is atomic mass, and the atomic number is also 92. So this is how we write the isotopic symbol of various elements. Now, relative atomic mass. Let's talk about, you see, the word relative atomic mass is important to us for us to understand what is going on. You see, because atoms occur naturally in mixed in isotopes. So what that simply means is that it works as a mixture of isotopes. So how, if we want to use an atom to work, how do we work with this atom? Are you going to keep working individually with each of the isotopes? No. We have to find an average of this number. What that simply means is that, so the numbers that you see in the periodic table, given below the periodic table, given in the periodic table, which simply shows the symbol and the name of the element in the periodic table, is important to us to understand. Now, this number, of course, is constant. This is Z, which is the atomic number. Now, but when you look at these numbers below, which represents the atomic mass, you see, these numbers usually come in fractions, usually come in decimals. Look at the decimals. And the reason why it comes in decimals is that it represents the average. The average of all the isotopes of atom. So it represents the average masses of all the isotopes of that atom that exist. And of course, you remember when you do your calculations in averages, what do you simply remember again? The isotopes, it usually takes you to remembering that most averages gives you decimals. It's usually not a complete you're going to get a whole number and the decimal part. That is why most numbers you see there are part of fractions. Though you get the whole number, you also get the fraction part. So that is why you cannot get any atom. Very difficult to look at the periodic table to see an atom that has a completely whole number atomic mass, because these masses just represent, like remember earlier we said chlorine has chlorine 37 and chlorine 35. So if we add those two isotopes of chlorine together and then work out the average mass, we now come up with a value that we call the average atomic or relative atomic mass of chlorine. And that is the number that you see in the periodic table. Now, that will take us to what we call the weight of the atom. Now, the atomic mass unit. The atomic mass unit simply represents the relative masses of all the atoms and isotopes of that element as calculated. Now, the instrument used in actually measuring this is the mass spec. And the operation of the mass spec is actually outside the purview of this class. However, it's important for us to understand that because carbon 12 occurs as the purest of the naturally occurring isotopes. It has been used to compare all other masses of the atom. So that is basically what this is telling you, that you use, we use other atomic atoms and measure and compare their masses to the mass of these pure isotope of carbon. So that is why we say that one atomic unit simply represents 1/12 of the mass of carbon 12. So, and the carbon 12 has a relative mass of 12U. So if we put that and move on, what do we now see? We see that if you want to get the relative mass of an atom or the relative average of an atom, it's as expressed in atomic units, or simply put, AMU. You see, you can use the symbol either AMU or U to represent the atomic weight or the atomic mass. You can call it atomic weight or the atomic mass of an atom. So what that simply means is that if I have chlorine, if you look at the periodic table, chlorine weighs or has a number, atomic mass of 35.45. What that simply means is that it measures 35.45 U or AMU. You can say U or AMU. So this can be, let's see, this can be 35.45 AMU. So anyone you use here actually doesn't matter. Again, if you look at oxygen to four digit, or can I usually like putting it, I usually tell students, try to write the atomic weight in two decimal places, or 100 of decimal places will give you 16.00 U. If you look again, phosphorus measures 30.97 U. So now, what is the importance of this? Why do we even know this? Now, if we want to figure out what we call the molecular formula or the molecular weight of an element, remember, in this page, we're talking about the relative atomic mass or weight of a single element. Now, what if we want to make this with respect to a molecule or a formula unit? What does that mean? So the relative mass of a molecule, a formula, or formula mass of an atomic compound simply means the mass of all this element expressed in mu. So what does this simply mean? You're going to get the atoms in this element or the element, the atoms in this compound, and add together all the individual relative atomic masses and come up with what the total is. So a good example is, this is water. Water is made up of two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen. So what do? We know that two atoms of hydrogen will be two times two atoms, and one atom of oxygen will be one times one atom of oxygen. Simply what that means is that 2 times 1.01 plus 1 times 16, if you add it together, the atomic weight of water molecule will be 18.02 atomic mass unit. Let's practice some of these examples here. So what is the molecular weight for the following compound? Of course, molecular is used to represent what we call covalent or molecular compound. We talk about this much later. So covalent or molecular compound, I'm telling you, when a compound is made up of two nonmetals. Yes, compound. If a compound is made up of two nonmetals, we use the word covalent or molecular for them. Now, so if you look at these two, they're all nonmetals. So what do? We add them together. Now, I want you to pick up your periodic table, open it, and begin to see what we're doing. The weight of sulfur here is 32.06, and it has only one atom. So I'm going to begin to add everything together. So it's going to be 32.06 plus, then oxygen is 3 oxygen atoms times the weight of oxygen. Now, I don't usually mind if you don't put the unit immediately. What matters is that at the end of the day, you have to put the unit together. If you do your mathematics very well or with your calculator, you're going to get 80.06 U atomic mass. So this represents the atomic weight, or what you say called the molecular weight of sulfur trioxide, this compound. You don't need to know the name for now. Let's go to this one. This is what we call urea. This compound is actually urea. So let's add it together. We have 1 carbon atom, this 1, I don't need to say times 1 because it's just 1, plus, I'm going to add plus, hydrogen atom, we have 4 of them. So 4 hydrogen atoms times the weight of hydrogen is 1.01, plus nitrogen, there is 2 atoms, and each of them weighs 14.01, plus oxygen weighs 16.00. If you do your mathematics together and add this thing, you get 60.07. You can always pause, finish the last one, and come back and check your answer. Now, let's do this, the last one. There are three hydrogen atoms, and that is 3(1.01), that is the weight of hydrogen, plus the weight of phosphorus is 30.97, plus oxygen. There are four atoms of oxygen there, so what it means is that 4 will multiply 16.00. And if you add everything together, the weight of this molecule is going to be 98.00 atomic mass units. So that is how we calculate the atomic weight of elements. So pause this video and try this next problem. After trying it, you can always come back and check your answers if you know you got them correctly. So let's do that real quickly. So calcium weighs 40, and there are three atoms. So we're going to start. So this will be 3 × 40.08, if you look at your periodic table well, plus, now look at, I like putting this bracket, and it means a lot. Let's try to understand it, particularly in ionic compound. Now, again, I have to say this. You see, it says determine, use the periodic table to determine the formula weight. The word formula weight is associated with ionic compound. Ionic compounds are compounds that are made up of a metal plus a metal plus a non-metal. So if you look at all these examples, they're all metal first with a non-metal, and we use the word formula weight to refer to them. We cannot call them molecules because they are not molecules. So continuing on our problem, 3 × 40.08 of calcium. Now, what about phosphorus? How many atoms of phosphorus do we have here? Look at this. This bracket will be treated as a mathematical parenthesis. What it means is that these 2 × 1 of phosphorus in the substrate, in the subscript, we're going to have 2 phosphorus atoms. So it's going to be 2 × 30.97 of phosphorus plus, again, there are 4 atoms here, but in parenthesis, these 2 will have to multiply this, and 2 times this is going to give you 8. What it means is that there are 8 atoms here, and we're going to multiply that with the weight of oxygen. And if you add everything together, it's going to give us 1310.18 atomic mass units. And that is how we do that. Again, for sodium, we do this one. So this will be, there are 3 sodium atoms. Sodium weighs 22.99. Add it. Plus, nitrogen weighs 14.01, and there's only 1 atom, so we don't need to do anything with that. Just 1 atom alone, 14.01. And when you add it together, it's going to give you 82.98U. Again, aluminum nitrate. Aluminum nitrate will be, aluminum weighs 20, it's not only 1 atom. And what is the weight of aluminum? Aluminum weighs 26.98. Only 1 atom plus nitrogen. Now look at the bracket again. There is 1 atom of nitrogen inside, and if you multiply by 3, it gives you 3. So there are 3 atoms. The 3 bracket, 14.01. Close the bracket, plus. And now look at oxygen. There are 3 oxygen atoms inside, but because of the parenthesis, parenthesis will be a multiplier. 3 × 3 will give you 9. So there are 9 atoms of oxygen. So this will give you 9 × 16. And if you add everything together properly, is going to give you 213.01 atomic mass units. So you can always use U or MU to represent the weight of these atoms, and it doesn't make any difference. So we're getting close to the last part of this lecture, isotope and atomic weight. Remember earlier what I told you, that the isotopes, relative atomic weight you see in the periodic table represent the average of all the atoms or all the isotopes of that particular atom that exists. So the atomic weight of elements that occur as a mixture of isotopes is the average of the relative atomic mass of the atoms in that isotopic mixture. Now, what that simply means is the average mass of each particle in a group of atoms is usually obtained by, if you add the total of the mass of each group and you divide it by the particles in that group. So, of course, if you remember the way we do averages is that you add the total population divided by the number of people in that population. So, what it simply means, the practical way of doing this is determine the average mass of atom is what? Is to use the imaginary sample of the element containing 100% of that atom. And this percentage, we usually refer to it the relative abundance. Relative abundance simply means how much of this atom exists, and we represent that as a percentage of each isotope. So we get this total mass contributed by the isotopes and divide it by the total population. So let's see a very good example. Now, I want to tell you this. You are not going to be tested on this particular concept in exam, but it's good you understand that the reason why atoms actually exist as fractions and not as whole, just whole numbers without the decimal portion. So it says a specific example is shown below. We're going to see, I'm going to show you this example the way it is. I'm not going to try to make you to do it. So I'm going to just show you what is. So boron consists of 19.78 boron 10 and 10.01 with the mass of this. And another one that has a mass of this. Remember, the mass for now is measured in what? In atomic mass. If I'm going to calculate the average, so the atomic weight or the atomic mass will be, I'm going to write this, atomic mass of this is going to be. Now, what it means is that, now, boron 10 has a mass of this, and this is the percentage. So it's going to be 90 point, it calls us 8%. I'm going to multiply this times by the mass of that one. This is the mass. I'm going to put a bracket plus. Now, this one exists at this percentage, 80.22. Now, I'm going to multiply it by the mass of this one, boron 11. Boron 11 has this mass, and it occurs this much. So if you multiply all these things together and divide it by 100, because we are assuming that all of them exist over 100, and how do you get that? If you add 80.22 plus 19.78, it's going to give you 100. So if you work out your mathematics very well, this is going to give you 10.81 atomic mass unit. And if you look at your periodic table, you see this value exactly matches the value you have in the periodic table. So that is how that value was actually arrived at, by seeing that boron occurs in two isotopes, getting these two isotopes and working out this math. This is exactly what has been done with the mass spec for all this problem. The last one we're going to do, but not the least, is going to be, says calculate the average atomic mass of chlorine given the following information. Chlorine 35 has this mass, but occurs 75.53% of the times. Then chlorine 37 has this mass and occurs this number of times. Remember again, to get atomic mass, I'm going to say atomic mass now. What am I going to do? I'm going to take the first one. I'm going to take the percentage 75.53. I'm going to multiply by the weight. The weight of this one, this is chlorine 35, and the weight is what? So this is this one, chlorine 35, weighs 34.97. I'm going to put a bracket plus. I'm going to the weight of the other one. The other one is chlorine what? Chlorine 37. And chlorine 37 weighs this. But the percentage of its occurrence, or what we call the relative abundance, is 24.47. I'm going to multiply this by 36.97. Now, I'm going to multiply this two. Then if I do my calculation very well and divide this by 100, if you want to get 100, you're going to be 75.53 plus 24.47 will give you 100. And that will be equal to 34.45. And if you look at this, this is the number you find in the periodic table. And that is how that value was arrived, from calculating the average of the two isotopes of chlorine. At this point, we've come to the end of this class. Thank you once again for listening. Please, I want to remind you that if you have any difficulties not understanding these lectures, please reach out to me during my office days. The best way to reach out to me is to send me email or send me messages through the Canvas. And once again, remember, apart from my dedicated office days, I have an open door policy that you can always come in and talk to me. Thank you once again for listening. I will see you next time.